Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Apologies have been received from Natalie Dawn, so I'm pleased to say Evelyn Tweed is attending as her substitute. The first item of business today is a decision to take items 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. The next item is to take evidence on the statement of reasons lodged to accompany the draft proposal on the Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council Bill, and for the committee to decide whether it is satisfied with the reasons given by the member for not consulting on the draft proposal. The committee is not required at this stage to give our views on the contents of the proposed bill, but I welcome to the meeting the member in charge of the bill proposal, Mark Griffin, MSP, and Mary Dinsdale, Senior Assistant Clerk from the Scottish Parliament's Non-Government Bills Unit. I refer members to paper 1 and invite Mark Griffin to make a short opening statement, please.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, members, for giving me the opportunity to attend committee this morning just to talk through the statement of reasons accompanying my draft proposal. This bill proposal was in response to reports that thousands of people were suffering from long COVID contracted at work, most likely the workers in health, social care, retail and public transport. We all depended on them. We applauded them throughout the course of the pandemic. But in the absence of any action from the UK Advisory Council, a Scottish Council could commission the research and come up with recommendations on how to support people who caught COVID, nurses, care workers, supermarket staff who now suffer with long COVID and are no longer fit for work. And when I looked further into the industrial injury system, it also became clear that it's completely out of date. It only really recognises injuries and illnesses for male workers in occupations that were common in the previous century, doesn't recognise modern occupations, and also completely fails female workers. Just 6.5% of applications under the prescription route come from women. Now, of course, Kimira, the purpose of this session is for me to for the committee to decide whether to accept the statement of reasons or not, and the detail that I've provided about why I consider it unnecessary to carry out a further consultation. But I did want to give the committee a flavour of the motives behind the proposed bill. I also note that you have received a letter from the Scottish Government, and I hope to work with the Minister to overcome any policy differences, any issues with a timetable. But again, as the committee will know, nothing in the Minister's letter is relevant to the statement of reasons today. So on the statement of reasons, it's less than a year since the draft proposal was lodged and the consultation began. It's just 6 months since the consultation summary was lodged ahead of Parliament rising for the election. That process was undertaken with the support of the Non-Government Bills Unit, and I just wanted to put on record my thanks for their support throughout that process. And the terms of the draft proposal are broadly similar to the proposal I lodged last November to establish a Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council, but I have improved the wording to sharpen up the proposal and reflect more precisely the purpose and role of the council that was consulted on and the outcome of that consultation process. There's nothing new which was not previously consulted on and on which views were sought. The additional terms confirm, firstly, that the council will be a statutory body, which was explicit throughout the consultation document and at question one in the consultation questions. Secondly, that it will have the ability to commission its own research, again made clear in the aims of the bill and specifically consulted on at question two. And third, to define its membership, which was the focus of question five. Now, that consultation on the previous proposal ran for 12 weeks and received responses from a range of individuals and organisations from relevant sectors. I wrote to a number of academics, civil society and third sector organisations, professional associations and business organisations, as well as occupational safety campaigns and, of course, trade unions. I think there is a breadth of responses from across those sectors, providing new positive engagement in the social security space. The consultation was also publicised in comment pieces and blogs in the Herald and the Daily Record and on Reform Scotland's Melting Pot blog and media coverage where I highlighted the issue raised in the consultation document that COVID-19 should be prescribed as an industrial disease, which was also raised with the First Minister in December. Close the Gap also blogged about both the gaps in provision for women and the existing benefit, but also women's health and safety more widely, and again talking about COVID-19 in the workplace. There were two events conducted on Facebook and via Zoom, which were hosted by the GMB's Health and Safety Group, where their members and separate focus groups were arranged with women members who shared their experiences of health and safety in the workplace. The consultation closed in February of this year, and I don't believe that respondents' view will have changed since then, nor have there been any material changes to the case for an advisory council. The UK Advisory Council since then has refused to prescribe COVID-19, which perhaps strengthens the case for evolution of the benefit here, and the Scottish Government has not yet made any legislative commitments to establish a new council. So repeating the consultation for a process which has been carried out so recently would seem to me to be an unnecessary duplication of work and effort, including for those organisations and individuals who took the time to respond to the previous consultation. So, Convener, I hope that members will agree that further consultation is not necessary, but I'm more than happy to expand on any of those points and take questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Griffin. I should, at this stage, thank all of those correspondents that have been in touch ahead of today's meeting. Certainly my inbox has been rather full of emails regarding this subject, so I thank all those that have been in touch and invite colleagues to ask any questions if there are any. Yes, Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for setting that out, Mark. We've received a number of emails, as the Convener's already said, from people calling for COVID-19 to be made an industrial disease in the new benefit, and others have said that women make up just a fraction of the applicants and that the benefit must start to recognise women's injury and disease in the workplace. Your bill isn't actually proposing to do that, so could you tell the committee how it will contribute to dealing with those issues?
Yeah, I'm glad to hear that your inboxes are so full, but perhaps sorry for some of your staff who are dealing with that. But it does show the strength of feeling out there in support of these proposals. But Ms Duncan-Glancy is right that this proposal in itself won't change any of that, but it is the first step on that road. Like I said, this entitlement is fit for the 20th century, not the 21st century. And so having an employment advisory council with expertise, people with lived experience of actual 21st century workplaces, with expertise from epidemiologists and other experts in the field, from actually having a gender balance on that council to make sure that that workplaces that are predominantly female are actually the illnesses and injuries in those workplaces are reflected. Because I said in the opening statement, only 6.5% of applicants come from women now. If there was an equality impact assessment done of this benefit today, then it would immediately say this is entirely inappropriate. So for me, all of those aims and objectives are the end point, but the starting point is establishing the council with the expertise and the ability to commission the research to start to address those challenges.
Thank you.
Any further questions from colleagues? Certainly I note, Mr Griffin, from the Minister's correspondence that it is the Government's intention to bring forward legislation to bring about employment injuries assistance, and he suggests that this legislation is therefore unnecessary. How would you respond to that?
The Minister has set out that he intends to bring forward legislation to establish employment injuries assistance, and that is obviously something the Government has to do through as a result of the Scotland Act and the Social Security Act. But what the Minister hasn't said, and the Government haven't committed to, is establishing an advisory council to scrutinise the regulations that the Minister would lay on the new entitlement, and crucially for me, to carry out research in advance of that entitlement being established, because what we can do is either lift and replicate what I feel is a failed UK system that is completely out of date, or we can get the expertise on board early, set up the council, give advice to government, scrutinise those regulations, because I think all parties in this Parliament and government have accepted that independent statutory body to scrutinise social security legislation is right. That's why we've got the Commission on Social Security. And I'm asking that we go a step further, that we create another body with the expertise to actually look in depth at the range of injuries and illnesses that we see in Scottish workplaces, and then update that benefit so that it best serves the people of Scotland.
And you don't feel that that could be served or delivered in terms of scrutiny or advice provided through SCOS?
But what I'm proposing is that the membership of a Scottish industrial, a Scottish council would have representation from trade union membership. It would take primary legislation to change the role of SCOS to mandate that they had trade union membership, that they had workers' lived experience of illness and injury at work. So for me, and the committee will know as well, that SCOS already has a lot of work on their plate. So for me, it's important that we create a new body to specifically look at the very detailed nature of employment injuries assistance, but also to give it that research function to look at emerging illnesses, emerging injuries across the developed world to make sure that the Scottish system is fit for the 21st century and not for the last century.
I think that's very helpful. I don't know if any colleagues have any further questions. My only other question would be, before we actually take a decision on whether to allow you to proceed without having to reconsult, would be what your intentions would be in terms of liaising with the Scottish Government before you reintroduce your bill.
Yeah, well, I raised this issue with the First Minister in the Chamber, and I think I received a sympathetic response. I raised it with the Minister, flagged the consultation response and my intention to bring forward legislation, but I appreciate, I think he was only 2 or 3 days into the job, so it might have not been top of his list. But I really do want to work with the Minister. The Minister set out what he feels are concerns around policy and timetable, and I think I've got a track record through the BSL bill of working with the government to make sure that there are no concerns on either side, and I would want to open up discussions between the Minister and his officials and essentially have a joint working approach to make sure this is right and that it works for the people of Scotland.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Griffin. The committee will now make a decision on whether it's satisfied by the statement of reasons. I thank you both for your time this morning. I invite Mr Griffin and Mary Dinsdale to please step away from the table while the committee reaches an agreement. Thank you very much. I'll briefly suspend. Thank you very much indeed. As I mentioned, the committee is now required to make a decision on whether it is satisfied with the statement of reasons and that a further consultation on the proposal is not necessary. We're not required at this stage to give our views on the contents of the bill. So the question is the committee satisfied by the statement of reasons? Yes. We are agreed. Thank you very much. The committee is satisfied by the statement's reasons. The minute will reflect this decision and we can now move on. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Mr Griffin. We turn now to our next item of business, which is an evidence session on homelessness and rough sleeping. We are planning to hold some standalone evidence sessions on topics covered within the committee's remit to establish priorities for future work this session. This is the first of these focused sessions. Given that homelessness is also of interest to the local government, Housing and Planning Committee, we invited members of that committee to join today's session, in addition to Mr Briggs, who is a member of both committees, and I have a great pleasure to welcome Elena Whittam, welcome Deputy Convener of the Local Government Housing Planning Committee to our meeting. I hope that we can continue to do such joint committee scrutiny where issues cross over during the course of this session. I also welcome to the meeting our panel who are joining us remotely, hopefully. We have Maggie Brunes, Chief Executive of the Homeless Network Scotland, Lorna Campbell, Financial Wellbeing and Revenues Manager from Dumfries and Galloway Council, Lorraine McGrath, Chief Executive Simon Community Scotland, Dr Beth Watts, Senior Research Fellow, Heriot Watt University, Gordon McCrae, Assistant Director of Shelter Scotland. A few housekeeping points for colleagues in the room and those joining us remotely. Please allow broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphones on before you start to speak. Witnesses can indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans or simply with a show of hands if you wish to come in on a question, and I'll do my best to monitor that as best I can. Don't feel you have to answer every single question. If you have nothing new to add to what's already been said by others, that's okay. I also invite members to please direct their questions to particular panellists. We're very fortunate that we have such a wide panel before us today, but in the interest of time, we have about an hour and a half. I would hope that we can direct our questions to individuals, please. So I would now like to invite colleagues to ask questions, and my first question is coming from Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you, Camilla, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if I could maybe start this question and aim it at either Lorraine or Gordon. And it's really just looking at the lessons learned in the last 18 months in the pandemic, during the pandemic. Clearly, there was a lot of work done around homelessness, and we almost saw the end of people on the streets at all for that period last year. I suppose for me, and it's quite a broad question, is what are the lessons we learnt there? And have we regressed even since then, whether local authorities, third sector, Scottish Government, and or have we learnt those lessons and are we now implementing them as we go forward? And maybe one of those two, maybe Gordon, you could start, and then over to Lorraine, if that's okay.
Thank you. I think what I would start by saying is what the pandemic showed is that greater resources, more staff, better joint working with the third sector and public bodies does actually work. And I think from our perspective, looking at where the levels of homelessness are, not just rough sleeping, but homelessness more general, it exposed some of the things that we can do well, but also exposed some of the things that we had maybe lost sight of. So the fact that there were significantly more people ending up in the hotel accommodation than were approaching the hostels prior to the pandemic, for us, tells us a story that there was still a problem with some people being prepared to approach, you know, have their perception of what the homelessness system through the local authority would enable for them. But we've also seen, you know, particularly in Glasgow, and certainly Lorraine can talk more to the practical steps that were taken, but Shelter Scotland, we actually took Glasgow City Council to a judicial review a couple of years ago now on their continued breaches around what we call gatekeeping, the inability of some people to access the temporary accommodation system. We've seen that pretty much go away during the pandemic. And I think that's a testament to, as I say, the resources. We have seen new staff, new casework teams, new property becoming available. Now, from our perspective, that wasn't a surprise. That was what we were pushing for the whole time. It's regrettable it took a health pandemic to bring in that shift. The challenge now is that it's difficult to disaggregate exactly where that money has come from, how much of that money and staffing can be retained. We certainly look to the Scottish Housing Regulator's data to try and keep abreast of just what the sustainable level of resources needed in the city. But Lorraine's team are far more involved in the on the ground day to day than shelter teams. So happily hand over to her.
Thank you.
Thanks, Gordon, and good morning, everybody. Delighted to be joining you this morning. I completely agree with everything Gordon just said there. I think the pandemic presented an incredible opportunity, and I'm happy to say that the work that had been done in interagency liaison in relation to rough sleeping in particular and people with complex needs really came into its own in a remarkable way. And a lot of that was about people feeling empowered at the front line, which was a key pillar of the frontline work from HRSAG and the organisations involved in that. But how do we actually put decision-making power into the hands of the people who have the best connections and the best relationships with people experiencing the most extreme forms of homelessness, such as rough sleeping and other forms of kind of destitution? The fact that we were able to mobilise so quickly was great, and the fact that we very quickly removed the institutional barriers and the professional hierarchy that often gets in the way, and the need for protocols and pathways and processes, and we focused on people and what those individuals and those groups of people needed in that moment, and how we could respond in that moment more effectively, and how collectively, I think quite remarkably, big parts of the system and individual leadership, local, operational level leadership, seen that opportunity to act and seen that opportunity to do things that we always knew was possible and we always knew which was important to the people we supported, but for one reason or another, for institutional reasons, system barriers, all of that, we'd never been able to make happen. But the circumstances of the pandemic gave power to that decision making and that power to that action, and people seen opportunity rather than challenge and risk and took those opportunities with people. We are of course talking about the most extreme forms of homelessness here in terms of rough sleeping, which tends to be the focus of discussions, but there was a lot of other activity around people who had lower level needs going on in the background with the councils as well, in terms of being able to rapidly access accommodation and stay safe. And a critical part of that was being able to support people who were perceived to have no recourse to public funds to respond to that with accommodation and get them into places of safety. And as a result of that, we built a much greater understanding of their needs through an ability to take a much more intensive case management because they were in stable accommodation, where they were able to engage with staff and engage with other services, build that understanding as well. What stayed in place is a lot of that frontline empowerment and a lot of those relationships that were formed during those highly pressured periods have been sustained. Well, there is a little bit of bureaucracy starting to creep back in. Of course, there is. People's own day jobs are taking more priority again, rather than being able to invest in working with their colleagues across the sector. But what I would say, and what has contributed heavily to our ability to keep the numbers of rough sleepers low in both cities, is that collective endeavour around a person, not a problem, not a number of people, not a system challenge, not a resource challenge, but what that person's circumstances are and what we can do collectively to make a difference to that, that person's circumstance and everybody else that comes along. And that still remains, I think, one of the most powerful drivers, along with the additional resources that obviously Gordon referenced within the cities as well.
Thank you very much indeed to you both. Next set of questions from Elena Whittam, please.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for actually inviting us to come from the Local Government Committee today to give evidence. Before I start, I would like to say to former colleagues on the evidence panel this morning, whom I work closely with in terms of my Cosla Housing spokesperson lead during the pandemic, thank you very much for all the hard work. And listening to both Gordon and Lorraine there, I am struck by the fact that it was a collective endeavour. My grave concern we have at this moment is about whether that true multi-agency working that we saw and the step change, the removal of those institutional barriers, whether we start to slip back on that. And it is of a concern to hear Lorraine say that some bureaucracy is starting to creep back in. So my question is, are we likely to see increases in terms of homelessness presentations with changes that are coming down the line? So if we think about the end of furlough, the end of the longer notice periods in the private rented sector, and how can we make sure that we don't see the bureaucracy creep back in so that we start to see bad results for people again as they're presenting to councils? And if I can maybe direct that at Maggie first and then perhaps Gordon. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks, Elena. Good to see you. Thank you, committee, for taking evidence on homelessness and actually just considering this issue among your early priorities. It's obviously very important to each of us here. Maybe just in kind of starting to answer that question, I could maybe just remind everybody of what some of the key challenges were in homelessness before the pandemic, because it really matters in terms of understanding what's going to happen next. And I think in you know, as concisely as I can, broadly in four parts, our challenges were, first of all, making sure that we have the supply and access to housing in the places that people really want to live. And secondly, a system that's characterised by an over-reliance on temporary accommodation, and particularly the kind of length of time that people stay there. And of course, with not all of that suitable. Thirdly, about changing the conditions that create homelessness. Poverty reduction especially is a primary driver of homelessness, as we all know. And while laws to prevent homelessness are absolutely vital, and they are, that the fundamental shift in homelessness will happen much further upstream. And I think finally that key challenge is what's sometimes called the implementation gap. That we do have great policy and legislation on housing and homelessness in Scotland, we really do, but making sure that that policy delivers on the ground for every person in the way it was intended is you know, the key challenge going forward. And that, of course, needs more focus on implementation and just more value given, I think, to staying the course. And I think particularly that all matters because the pandemic has magnified all of that. So in addition to the immediate kind of public health risks, the pandemic has created the same conditions that create homelessness, which of course gets to Eleanor's point. So thinking about what might be around the corner, what's kind of ahead of us, we know that homelessness follows big global events like recessions and pandemics. And what we expect, I think, mostly is for homelessness to be a bit of a lagging indicator of this pandemic, that we may not see it immediately. And indeed, you know, the most recent statutory count of homelessness showed a slight reduction. But what we would tend to see is increases in homelessness a bit further down the road. I guess when people start to experience those money worries, the pressures on housing, on employment, the end of furlough, and all those other factors that will contribute to housing insecurity. So I think exactly what we need and what's been successful over the last period is that big government leadership that we've seen. It's really worked. This national endeavour, thinking about housing, health and home all together. Making sure that there is no rollback on that acute collaboration that happened over the period that Lorraine just described, because that too works. And we need things, of course, like Housing First at the helm to address just the severest and most multiple disadvantages, and to do that first.
Thank you, Maggie. Gordon, followed by Beth, please.
What we would say is, yes, that we should anticipate a rise in homeless presentations. I think we don't put too much stock on the homelessness stats for last year because clearly we had an effective evictions ban. One of the principal places from which people who make homeless applications were previously housed is the private rented sector. So there's a little bit of a false perspective in some respects as to what the levels of homelessness were at the point at which furlough ended, at which the courts reopened. So We certainly see that along with the cost of living crisis, the continuing, increasingly precarious nature of employment, the structural reasons for homelessness. And I think it's important when we talk about homelessness, we talk about statutory homelessness. Obviously we need to understand the levels of hidden homelessness, but Scotland's system is based on rights and duties, based around the statutory framework. And I'm struck by some of the evidence, especially from the Crisis Homeless Monitor and elsewhere. We had failed to make a real dent in homelessness through any of the, despite a very positive set of initiatives around ending homelessness together, Housing First, many different individual initiatives. We weren't seeing a significant reduction. In fact, homelessness was on the rise, was trending up 2 years in a row before the pandemic. And I think sometimes we just need to kind of just remind ourselves the scale of the challenge that we face. Rough sleeping is absolutely the acute end of the homelessness system, but it is in numerical terms a relatively small proportion of the size of the problem. And I would absolutely endorse Maggie's comment about the implementation gap. And I think we now actually have a moment to reflect on how do we get a whole systems approach to tackling the homelessness problem in Scotland. We have, we absolutely endorse models like Housing First, like extending prevention duties to other public bodies. But we think we also have to take a step back and recognise there's been a 75% increase over the last 6 years of children in temporary accommodation, more than 7,000 children in temporary accommodation. We know the harm that causes to their life opportunities. We need to avoid deep diving into one narrow piece of the homelessness sector and do take that broader role. Some of the elements of the Ending Homelessness Together annual report, which haven't yet been progressed, gendered analysis of the system, the embedding stronger ability to get recourse on your rights where they're denied. We, as difficult as it is, we need to approach the issues of homelessness with equal energy across the piece. And we are concerned that if we only focus in on one area, we have an unintended consequence in another. And certainly the rise in children in temporary accommodation, we think, is a direct result of a focus solely on the rough sleeping and more acute end, as we see people who aren't even counted in when we talk about things like core homelessness, which is a statistical model, not a legal model. It explicitly excludes people who are in long-term temporary accommodation. So these are some of the consequences. We do need, a whole systems approach. We think there are some really good pillars of what that will take, better rights, but ultimately more homes. And the more homes, but we can't achieve Housing First if there aren't the tenancies for people to move into. We can't achieve rapid rehousing if there aren't the homes for people to access. But we don't want to go backwards into forms of priority needs where some groups are deemed to be more important than others simply because of a set of circumstances. We support the needs-based analysis that looks at people who are making presentations at that time. I think that the structural need for more resources, for more homes, is actually the lesson to learn from the pandemic. When we put the money in, when we put the energy in, when Scottish Government take a leadership role as well, which is one thing we didn't touch on earlier, Scottish ministers taking a leadership role in the response to the pandemic, putting cash directly into third sector bodies to do that immediate response. These things make a difference, and we're very keen that through the work of the committee and through the forums like the housing, the homelessness policy strategy group, that we're able to continue that progress.
Thank you, Gordon. Beth, please.
You can hear me. Hi, I hope you can hear me now. There's absolutely no doubt that there's a really acute concern among local authorities in particular that we will see that rise in homelessness, and I think we need to take that very seriously. I think from a range of sources there is a reason to be somewhat optimistic. The lesson from, I think, international UK-wide homelessness policy and trends is that these negative impacts of the economy on homelessness aren't inevitable. There's nothing necessary about them, and policy plays an extremely important role in sort of breaking that link between these economic factors and homelessness rising. I wanted to draw attention to work in the monitors projecting trends in homelessness over various time horizons, and to pull out a few core messages from that. And the core message really is that some of the things that can make the most difference to stabilising and actually substantially reducing homelessness in Scotland are within the hands of Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament. There are some that would help that are out of our hands, but the key ones actually that can make a big dent are within the hands of Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament. Moreover, they're things that are already in the Ending Homelessness Together Action Plan. So I really want to underline that I think the core focus should be on seeing that plan through over a longer time horizon than the initial 5 years that was understandably the focus. Rapid rehousing into settled housing, whether that's social housing or whether that's appropriate private sector housing, that is projected to make a huge difference on numbers in both the short and medium term. And in addition to that, maximising prevention, and there's a huge amount more that can be done in Scotland to really maximise the gains from homelessness prevention, which I hope we'll go on to talk about. I'll leave it there.
Thank you very much indeed, Beth. Elena, have you got a supplementary there?
Actually, it's just more of a kind of a winding up comment on that section for my question. I think that I think we need to put a marker down on the implementation gap of policy. I think that that's something that we have to recognise fully, because we do have, as Gordon and others have said, we do have world-leading legislation and rights and responsibilities that we have in Scotland. And I think that we have to recognise that the cross-committee work is truly important, because within my Committee of Local Government Housing and Planning, if we think about the housing system as a whole, the housing system really has to come together to respond to that, to make sure that we do have the supply of houses to be able to respond to any increase in homelessness or indeed the homelessness that we're seeing at the moment. So that's going to be fundamental, but I also think the National Planning Framework 4 is going to be vital for this, because we have to get that right too. So just to put the marker down with this committee and yourself, convener, that we do that cross work going forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Whittam. Pam Duncan-Glancy, you had indicated you wanted to come in here as well.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to all of the panel, and thank you for your testimony so far. I just wanted to ask a quick question on the temporary accommodation and also on evictions, because we touched on them. There's a large number, as we all know, of children in temporary accommodation. Could you say a bit about what we could do to try and move them rapidly, I think, as it's been described, and so that we could get them into more settled accommodation by Christmas? I mean, would that even be possible? I'd like to think so, but I'd be keen to hear how we could do that. And then the other point from the conversation we've just had is around evictions and the changing of the eviction ban. It was rightly pointed out that had a serious impact on the numbers. Can you talk about any concerns you have about the lifting of that ban and the impact that could have on homelessness going forward?
I want to direct that to.
Thank you. I promised I'd remember to do that as well. Could I ask Beth, maybe, if you could, Dr. Watts, if you could maybe comment on that, and also Maggie, please.
Hi, yes, very happy to. I recognise the very important sort of story that Gordon tells about the high numbers of children in temporary accommodation, and that absolutely should be a core concern for us. I do just want to reflect on the variability of temporary accommodation. Gordon mentioned our core homelessness sort of lens on homelessness, which is one way of looking at homelessness, which is broader than rough sleeping and overlapping with statutory homelessness. The reason we do that is because we think it's important to say that people in temporary accommodation can be in a range of better or worse circumstances. A few years ago, I did a study on temporary accommodation, and focusing in on families with children, it was very, very clear that some of those families were in an okay situation. They were in self-contained, furnished properties in a location they were okay with near the children's school. Some of them were not. They were extremely overcrowded in accommodation that was really, really unsuitable and damaging their lives in a number of ways. So I would just want to say that in terms of prioritisation, there are people with very different experiences there. We should be focused on getting all of them out of temporary accommodation, but I think we should maintain that sort of nuance in looking at the different situations people are in. I absolutely believe that there are things that we could do in the very short term. You know, you talk about pre-Christmas, and that might be a conversation for local authorities and landlords more than me, but certainly the lesson from the pandemic is that we can make very big substantial differences homelessness very, very quickly. And I think you're right to highlight that rapid rehousing should be the focus there. Prioritising households in temporary accommodation and homeless households or rapid rehousing into social housing and private rented sector accommodation that's appropriate could achieve that very, very quickly. On the evictions ban, I think that the key thing here is that the phasing out of that evictions ban is slow and managed. People aren't evicted overnight. It's a long process. That gives an opportunity for extremely good and intensive advice to be given, for landlords to really take responsibility for ensuring that evictions are only used when necessary and don't result in homelessness. Often in those situations, we can see homelessness prevention activity working really well, either in enabling that household to stay in that accommodation or in securing alternative appropriate accommodation for them before the eviction happens. So I think there's a real need to emphasise the sort of policy control we continue to have over the impacts of the phasing out of that eviction ban.
Thank you very much indeed, Dr. Watts. Maggie, please. Can you hear us?
Yes, sorry, yeah, thank you. I can see them on my phone there. Thank you. Okay, so first of all, on the point of temporary accommodation, and thanks, Pam, is such an important point. And I think, as I said earlier, it is one of the chief concerns in the homelessness system overall, is that we have a system that is characterised by households, including families with children, spending far too long in temporary accommodation and other individuals staying in unsuitable temporary accommodation. So it's a huge priority for those of us that are working in this sector. I think at the start of the pandemic that we almost ended rough sleeping and definitely did close communal night shelters by opening up hotel rooms and by local authorities finding access to other types of temporary accommodation is in that moment something that we were all on board with. And I think it's fair to say that any reflection on that period, we would probably all say the same. But the result of those actions, of course, is that now we're talking about 13,000 households in temporary accommodation, that's up significantly on the year before. And I think there was a period early on in the pandemic that it peaked right up at 14,000 households, which is the most ever. And that's already in a country that has an over-reliance in temporary accommodation as a tool to respond to homelessness. So it's a chief concern, but the fact, I think, that over the course of the pandemic, and given that we're still in the pandemic months, that local authorities are already starting to demonstrate a bit of reduction in the use of temporary accommodation from that peak to where we are now, shows first of all that progress is being done, but also that progress can be made on this if the right policy and practical decisions are made, and we're seeing some evidence of that at local level. What Beth just described is something that I feel very supportive of, which was set out clearly in the Homelessness Monitor, is that one of the key tools of reducing homelessness going forward and the reliance on temporary accommodation is simply increasing the proportion of lets that social housing providers and other providers make to homeless households. It is one of the most simple but effective mechanisms that we can put in place to just get the system moving faster and people spending less time in temporary accommodation and less of their lives in limbo, which of course is what's happening. I think maybe linked to that is that when local areas, particularly the local councils that are having the biggest challenges round about temporary accommodation, which as you'd expect would be the cities, are also the areas that are going to be finding the unsuitable accommodation order and the terms contained within that the most challenging one. Now, the principle of the unsuitable accommodation order is such an important one, that idea that if an accommodation isn't good enough for some of us, then it's not good enough for any of us. is absolutely important for us to hold on to. And I think, in fact, for many of us, it was the final piece in that jigsaw of creating a universal set of rights to people who are experiencing homelessness. And so it is incredibly important, and I know that everybody's on board with it. But the reality, I think, linked to the point before, is that there is a minority of local authorities that are just not going to be able to meet the terms of that. And I think fundamentally what we need to recognise is that those areas with the greatest challenges around about temporary accommodation overall and the related use of unsuitable temporary accommodation simply need the most support, and that support will need to come from national government as well as housing providers in the area and the range of housing, health, social care support providers that can help with that move on. And finally, just a quick point, I think, on the point of eviction. Our organisation, and actually alongside a wider collective of organisations, around 35 organisations under an umbrella called Everyone Home, which is third in academic sector organisations that mobilised at the start of the pandemic. One of our priorities is about seeing no evictions into homelessness at all. So understanding that there are circumstances where eviction cannot be prevented, particularly in the cases of antisocial behaviour or others, there can be no grounds where we can expect people to leave a household into no roof at all. And there's much more that can be done around about preventing that and actually just committing to that as a principle, as in national policy terms, as well as what happens locally. One of the things we hear in terms of housing associations and their position around about eviction is on the point of rent arrears, is that eviction would never be started if somebody in a rent arrears had a payment plan with the housing association and were meeting the terms of it, and maybe some additional support around about that as well. And I think what a number of us want to do is support that, and I think probably have some more evidence that that's always the case in all areas and across all housing associations, but absolutely to provide more tools and support to enable housing associations to stick to that as a principle, because it's the right one.
Thank you very much indeed, Maggie. As we're talking about prevention, I'd like to bring in Lorna Campbell here, please, to talk about the work that's been done in the local authority setting, particularly around financial resilience, and touching the points that were made there by Maggie around rent arrears and ensuring that people have financial resilience in order to try to avoid falling into homelessness. Lorna, could you touch on those areas from a local authority perspective, please?
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, convener. Yes. Obviously, I mean, I'll talk from a local perspective in Dumfries and Galloway, but probably what I'll say is it'll apply across most local authorities. We have been focused for, obviously, prior to the pandemic, quite heavily on the prevention side, and particularly around rent arrears. And at the start of the pandemic, we did work very closely with our housing associations, because what I should say is Dumfries and Galloway is a stock transfer authority, so we don't have our own housing stock, but we do work very closely with our main housing provider and all the other housing associations, particularly with tenants who have rent arrears and are struggling financially, and put additional supports in there to work with those teams to look at areas such as benefit maximisation, underlying reasons, referrals into employability schemes, if that was appropriate. Obviously, recently we've had the addition of the COVID tenant support grant, which has been given to local authorities from the beginning of September. And we've been working again with housing associations, but also private sector landlords, to highlight any tenants that do have arrears, particularly around COVID, and working with those landlords and tenants to get engagement and work with them to address the arrears. I think picking up the comments from earlier about the potential evictions and the current economic climate with the ending of furlough and the changes to things like universal credit and the other economic situations that are putting a squeeze on people with low incomes. I think at the moment we're not seeing a rise in evictions, and I think it's already been explained there is going to be a time lag before that actually we start to see homeless presentations because of that. But what we are seeing is local authority is increased demands for things like discretionary housing payments, Scottish welfare funds, which probably is a precursor to that people are beginning to struggle, and that these eventually are going to lead to people, you know, struggling with their tenancies. But because we have those contacts already in place, there's very much a cross-sector approach with our housing associations, with our sector, citizens' advice, to actually get support in as early as possible to help tenants work with these agencies to help address any issues that they may have and eventually obviously prevent the homelessness occurring.
Thank you very much indeed, Lorna. Before I bring Miles Briggs in, I know that Gordon McRae would like to come in again at this stage. Gordon.
Thank you. Just very briefly, I wanted to sort of directly address the question Ms. Duncan-Clancy raised about what could be done now. And I think Maggie mentioned the unsuitable accommodation orders, which have been extended to all households. Something we really support was long overdue and much delayed, but it didn't attract any additional funding for local authorities to implement it. And I think one of the things we do need to look at are more responsibilities being placed on local authorities from central government without additional capacity and resource coming in to meet that new goal. I would point out that there's probably the 7 local authorities that are going to be in breach from day one, are already in breach of those new duties. But it's important we recognise that those are legal rights. And in Shelter Scotland, we certainly have cases every day where we are defending the rights of people who have been denied temporary accommodation, suitable temporary accommodation. And it's a way in which we seem to tolerate breaches of legal duties in the homelessness system that we wouldn't tolerate in other areas. It'd be unfathomable to imagine a local authority denying a child the right to education, a place at school, and yet we routinely, before the pandemic and post-pandemic, we have local authorities breaching their legal duties to provide suitable temporary accommodation. And that's why when we at Shelter, we are increasingly trying to shift the discussion away from how do we do the best with what we've got within the housing and homelessness sector to how do we create the structural changes that are required. We don't accept the local authorities have to focus on reducing harm with an ever-reducing budget. There's been small amounts of money, £8 million, £50 million over the next few years, but if there's one thing that can be done, it's connect resource to new policy requirements and duties from here on out.
Thank you very much indeed, Gordon. Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us this morning. I wanted to ask around temporary accommodation for your input into trends around the individuals we're actually talking about, because findings from the Hard Edges research at Heriot Watt University has showed the complex needs of individuals often see them falling through the gaps of services. Now, I know from my 5 years in MSP, trying to assist people, often these are ex-military, people with learning disability issues, people who have drug and alcohol problems. So I just wondered, in terms of individuals who just seem to be constantly in temporary accommodation by councils, if you had any evidence you could provide to the committee on that, and whether or not different models, for example, supported living models, is something we should really be trying to look at, where individuals can't necessarily hold down a tenancy. So I wondered if we could have your views on that, and having referenced the research, I should maybe bring in Beth to start.
Hi. Thank you. Great question. So I want to make a preliminary point and then I'll come to the sort of question of solutions. I think the preliminary point is that the group you referred to and that is the focus of that Hard Edges research, they're experiencing a huge amount of challenges anyway. And I wanted to emphasise that some of the forms of temporary accommodation they have access to, and it's understandable why, you know, within the current system, local authorities are putting them in those forms of accommodation, hostels and bed and breakfast. These can exacerbate the situation. Scotland should be very, very proud of its legal rights on homelessness. It should be very proud of having rights to temporary accommodation for people experiencing homelessness. But there are too many people in temporary accommodation and it isn't fit for purpose. And it especially isn't fit for purpose for exactly this group that you highlight, Miles. So I wanted to emphasise that. The Hard Edges report, one of the key messages for that was that local authority housing and homelessness departments really end up carrying the can for this group when this group's needs are so much broader than housing and homelessness. And it's absolutely essential in moving forward that we recognise that. That is an absolutely key principle of the Prevention Review Group recommendations on bringing other public sector bodies to the table to really contribute to this. So I just wanted to emphasise that. In terms of the actual housing solutions, I want to make two points, and I'd really recommend you come to Maggie after me on this. Housing First, which I'm sure members of the committee are familiar with to some extent, is a key solution for the majority of this group. A hugely well-respected set of evidence demonstrating that even people with those very high levels of complex needs can function and indeed flourish in self-contained housing if the support is right, if the wraparound support that they need is right. There are, though, a very small subgroup of that group of people who do need something else, and really delighted to have been involved in some work sort of headed up by Homeless Network Scotland to think about the role of, you know, supported accommodation for those whom Housing First doesn't work for. And there's a few brilliant publications that have come out really setting a policy direction for that, and it is about foreign cluster model, so maintaining the principles of self-contained accommodation, but making sure that that support is available on site in an even more intensive way for the people who need it. And I think this has been a gap in the sort of amazing policy making that's been happening in Scotland on homelessness over the last few years. So it'd be really nice to square that circle.
Any further?
We can maybe bring Maggie in, and specifically on that point which you raised, Beth. One of the issues which I think is important to note, and we've already heard that 9 local authorities are likely to be in breach, or at least 7 will be in breach of the unsuitable accommodation order. But what accommodation is necessarily out there for these individuals we're talking about? I know on a visit I undertook last Friday in my own region that there's over 50 people in Edinburgh with alcoholic brain damage who are currently on waiting lists to try to get into supported living. So that accommodation doesn't necessarily seem to be in existence currently. And also, when we look at the support people need, wraparound care is expensive and the workforce isn't necessarily there. So I just wondered, I'll maybe come on to Maggie now, what really does this committee need to suggest to government needs to be put in place for this individual group? Because my experience is people often end up just pinging around services, sadly. So I wondered, in terms of your expert opinion, what you think could be a solution for that cohort of clients we're talking about. Maggie. And on that note, we've lost you.
Okay, hello, can people hear me?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. Sorry, something froze there. I've got a feeling it was me. Okay, so I'll answer the question I think I was being asked. And maybe the starting point, again, similar to Beth, is just to state, because it's important that most of us, with the right support, can manage our own home, and even that kind of hard edges group that we're talking about. When we're talking about, Miles, as you described, people that you see that aren't getting the type of response that they need, and if we can consider at least some of that, is about Housing First being the right model, but not yet being at sufficient capacity to reach everybody that needs it. So what we know, for example, through the Pathfinder today, is that we're now over 550 people have accessed their own tenancy, and high numbers of people are sustaining that successfully. But that is a drop in the ocean in terms of some of the modelled forecasting that's been done around about level of demand for Housing First going forward. And the type of numbers that we're talking about are about 3,500 people across the country a year over the next 10 years is the level of Housing First that we need to meet to enable everybody to access that type of support and service. So you can see that we are some distance away from reaching that. And you know, one of my key points around about Housing First is in recognising that while we do have a majority of local authorities now committed, a significant majority committed to Housing First, and in fact already delivering Housing First, that the types of numbers and forecasts around about Housing First are far too modest. And we really do need to be thinking much bigger. Now, with all that said, what we do know from Housing First that was explained in the interim evaluation that was an independent evaluation undertaken by colleagues at Heriot-Watt University, is that there's three circumstances where Housing First doesn't work. And that is generally where people just don't have the capacity to understand the terms of a tenancy agreement. And secondly, where their level of health and support care is just beyond what can be provided with an independent mainstream tenancy. And thirdly, people that just don't want that. And it's not that they won't always not want their own place, but whatever their circumstances are, they don't want that right now. So the piece of research that's just published last month is one that explored those circumstances. So these three circumstances with people and where Housing First isn't going to work for the groups that we're talking about, and then what is it that's needed? And so this was a significant piece of research and also a policy position that was fine-tuned by a research advisory group that had a number of key partners on it, including national and local government, Housing Support Enabling Unit, providers of supported housing and other partners. So what in summary, the recommendations of that research and the policy position are setting out is a direction of travel towards supported housing being a settled housing option for a small number of people that want or need 24-hour support that is on site and available to them. It's currently used in a temporary kind of form, and what we want to do is push it toward a settled housing response, because for some people, that small group of people that we're talking about, that's exactly what's needed. That should be homely and should fit all national policy objectives round about independent living, and that as far as possible, that should be not labelled as a homeless accommodation, because it should be somebody's that's somebody's home. And so if we can look at models that are already provided in health and social care and core and cluster independent living places, that's exactly the type of model that we should be aspiring to as a response to homelessness as well. Some of the modelling that's been done round about scale suggests that the scale of need for that type of supported housing with on-site support is between 2 to 5% of the number of people that make a homeless application every year. So that's across the country. So that's somewhere between 400 and 1,300 people. So we really are talking about a small number of people, but it's an incredibly important group of people, and they just need that better response, Miles, that you've highlighted.
Could I bring in Lorraine Campbell? Lorraine McGrath at this stage as well, please. You'd indicated you wanted to come in here.
Yeah, I would absolutely endorse everything that's been said by Beth and Maggie there. And I think the start point is absolutely to see people and to see people in a way that they are able to achieve equity of access to health and social care services. Because one of the big challenges that we have, even with the success of Housing First, is that it still sits very much within a housing and homelessness agenda rather than a health and wellbeing agenda. And the issues, just as you outlined in the start of the discussion here, are much wider than their homelessness circumstance. That is, there are people with significant complex needs, and this is a group that makes up the majority of the people that we support across the country on an ongoing basis. And we know those people by name, by circumstance that you're referring to, particularly in Glasgow and Edinburgh. We know them. We know their histories, we know their engagement, and we have relationships with them. But one of the challenges that we've got is being able to achieve equity of access for them, for the whole health and social care system, to address that range of needs. You mentioned alcohol-related brain damage, for instance. There are a lot of people perceived to have that level of cognitive impairment, but who not easily have ever been able to access proper neuropsych assessments to get to a place of understanding of what their actual needs are. Is the barriers to access from a homelessness perspective to the other parts of the health and social care system are significant, and particularly around trauma response services, mental health services, the links between mental health and addictions and recovery services. And all of those issues become barriers to
people being able to move out with that temporary accommodation bounce about from service to service, because they either struggle to engage with what is available to them, or what is available to them doesn't provide enough safety and structure and security, and that becomes a problem for the service provider. So the fact that that we don't have an integrated model in most areas, where Housing First services, planned services sit out with health and social care structures, there isn't that level of integration yet. And obviously, an opportunity abounds right in front of us right now with the development of the National Care Service to address that and to create equity of access and equity of status as well, because there is no way that we would consider someone in a, let's say, a forensic learning disability supported accommodation service as homeless, because it's not their tenancy. We would not consider someone in older residential care as homeless. But we do consider someone in a homeless supported accommodation project to still be homeless, even if they are there for 12 months plus, 2 years plus, 3 years plus, as they rebuild their lives and recover from all of the harms that they've experienced that's led up to their homelessness, and then the further harms that they've experienced during their experience of homelessness. So I think it's one of the things that we need to kind of scale back and actually see the person and see them as someone with complex needs and complex issues, one of which happens to be homelessness. And there is a housing need there, and that housing needs to be focused very much on that individual person's circumstance. We know from work that we've done in Glasgow and from a multi-agency partnership that was brought together in Glasgow called the CAN Initiative, that focused on this very group in Glasgow, that we, when we do that and when we work collectively, address and to place that person right at the centre of that, and what will work for them, what works best for them based on who knows them best, who has the greatest trusted relationship with them, who has the opportunity to connect with that person from a relationship first point of view, then we can absolutely support that person to transform their lives. And some of the stories that are connected with that are just off the scale, you know, spine tingling, incredible. In terms of the impacts that people have been able to achieve for themselves with the right wraparound support. And then the last point I'd like to make is that we've yet to get that full system wraparound around Housing First in most areas. It does still lie with housing homelessness and largely the third sector as well. And we're doing a great job, but we can do better in terms of scale, in terms of improvements in people's well-being within the Housing First service development. And if we can get that equity of access for people who are transitioning into settled living through the homelessness route.
Thank you very much indeed, Lorraine. I'd now like to bring in Faisal Chowdhury, please, followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, convener. I think the question probably towards Beth. Do you think the rapid rehousing transition plans are resourced well enough?
No, I don't. But I want to preface that no by saying that rapid rehousing transition plans are the right tool and the right mechanism, and that we have seen progress already with the implementation of rapid rehousing transition. We have seen more than half of local authorities change their social housing allocation policies in line with the principles of those plans. We have seen all local authorities produce such plans in ways that really reflect that they understand and are on board with the vision. We've seen increases in flipping the use of temporary accommodation where it's appropriate to do so. All of that is a really, really good start. The pandemic hit at a time where we may have been about to see an acceleration in the implementation and impact of those plans, and it made it harder. As a side note, local authorities also found rapid rehousing transition plans useful in guiding their response to the pandemic, but there's no doubt that the pandemic slowed that progress. In addition to that, the vision of transformation outlined in the detail in the Ending Homelessness Together action plan and sought to be implemented through rapid rehousing transition plans is a big one. And I think it was always going to be the case that that transition would take more than 5 years, which it will do. This is a longer term vision. It's the right vision. And what is absolutely essential now is that we see it through, and that requires more resource. There is absolutely no doubt about that. It's very clear from initial plans what local authorities asked for and what they were asking for funding to contribute to. These were all in line with the principles, and you know, the funding that was actually allocated fell short. That was recognised, and various boosts to that funding were given. And what we found in the Homelessness Monitor, that they were extremely highly valued by local authorities who want to see this vision through and are grateful for any further resource. They're not adequately resourced. They're the right tool. We need that resourcing and that longer term vision to extend beyond 2023. It would be a real tragedy if, having done so much incredible work in outlining the plan and the vision, progress slipped and we didn't sort of see through on this. I can make one final kind of historical brief point. In the 2000s, Scotland went through a massive transition in its response to homelessness that involved phasing out the priority need criterion, which blocked a lot of people from accessing, you know, the full right to rehousing that virtually all homeless households now do have access to. Now, that transition process took a decade, and it was the right one and it was a good one, and that transition was achieved successfully. But it was less multifaceted, and it was less challenging. It was less wide in scope than the transformation that Scotland is currently trying to pursue on homelessness. So I think we have to see this as both achievable, but achievable in the longer term. So, yes, that's my answer. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Beth. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Yeah, just following on from some of the themes, I've had a number of meetings with women's groups, particularly here in Lothian and Edinburgh. I know there's concerns that women and children can often be put in temporary accommodation, which is just not suitable. Either there's single men there, either there is no kind of proper facility for kitchens, or there's unsafe spaces. I just wonder what the panel's view, or maybe, oh, I haven't got the time for the panel, so maybe just direct this one at Shelter, if that's okay, at Gordon, to view on how Scotland's providing for homeless families and how can we do it different, particularly for children and women who are in this accommodation.
Gordon McRae, please.
I'll take anybody. He's on mute, I think he's.
Technology will catch up. Gordon McRae.
I'm happy if anyone else wants to jump in. I'm conscious of time. I don't know if anyone else wants to jump in if Gordon can't answer.
I think it's more...
We can't hear us.
Whoever's running the selection. Here we go. Oh,
there. I'm on. There we go. Sorry about that. If I can take the last two questions together very quickly. In direct response to your question, Mr. Balfour, the provision of accommodation for children, especially in the east of Scotland, not just Edinburgh, but the Lothians, Fife and the Borders as well, is totally inadequate. It is, you know, this is the area of the greatest need, affordable housing needs in the country, and we're not seeing the allocation of central government funds match where the greatest demand is. So the Scottish Government are building, or are certainly funding, the new social housing for the long term. This is the only long term answer that we have, but it's not yet directed in the places of greatest need. And we saw that the Audit Scotland report that came out at the very start of the pandemic, looking at the lack of additional impacts from the affordable house building programme, is something which I don't think really has had the scrutiny yet, just because of the way it came out. But I think does lay out the need for the next phase of the affordable house building programme to be specific in terms of what it should achieve. And for us, one of the things it must achieve is are larger properties for those families trapped in temporary accommodation. In terms of the short term, I've already mentioned there should have been some additional resource from central government to match the quite appropriate extension of the unsuitable accommodation order for single people, and seeing if that would in some respects alleviate the knock-on effect of allocations to people in temporary accommodation. So the single homeless people who are now covered by unsuitable accommodation order, obviously children and families were always covered by it, that is placing additional pressure on the already limited stock. And we do see examples of some people being placed in properties that are too big for them, at the same time some people are placed in properties that are too small for them. And it's just that kind of harm reduction, people needing to do today what it is they can. But if I could just pick up the bigger point, Mr. Chowdhury's question as well about funding, I would totally endorse Dr. Watt's point about the lack of resource. And if you look at the evaluation of Housing First that has been the interim evaluation, if we take a cost of somewhere between £8,000 and £14,000 per person housed, that would require a resource of somewhere between £30 and £50 million a year if we extrapolate that up to 3,500 people per year. We are some way from that. And obviously some of that cost is sunk within local authorities already. And it's not always about additional resources, it's about changing the way we work. But it does also for us reinforce that the comparison with the 2012 homelessness commitment shows us that it does take time, but the difference between 2012 and rapid rehousing is 2012 had statutory underpinning. Rapid rehousing is at this point in time just a best practice guide. There is no legal basis for rapid rehousing transition plans. If your individual is failed by a local authority, there is nothing in the rapid rehousing transition plan, unlike the homelessness strategy, that you could seek a judicial review or any other form of recourse. So we would like to see rapid rehousing plans put in a statutory footing so that it does embed and uphold the rights-based approach that Scotland has.
Thank you very much indeed, Gordon. I'd like to bring Evelyn Tweed in now, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, panel. My question is around rapid rehousing and Housing First and what actual benefits our service users get from these. I mean, are these developments really making a difference to people's lives? And I would like to ask Lorraine that question first, please.
I think that the easy answer is yes, absolutely. So, in particular in terms of Housing First, we people have access to their own home, good quality housing with wraparound support that they influence how it's managed, how it's delivered, how they receive that support, and they remain in control of that. They have access to furniture packages to make that house a home. They have access to a team of skilled staff who can advocate for them in terms of access to other services within the community that they go to live, in terms of accessing community engagement, meaningful activity, their own aspirations and goals. And there are stories in the 500-odd people that are across Housing First of Scotland at the moment. Some of the stories are just remarkable. We have stories of people who very recently were rough sleeping and in utter chaos and who would have fitted that category that Miles referenced earlier, who are now settled in their own home and either engaged in educational activity or pursuing employability options, re-engaged with their families, engaged in treatment for addictions and recovery from their mental health problems. I mean, the transformation for some people has been remarkable. Rapid rehousing actually has been the underpinning factor, I think, particularly in Glasgow in the last year, of the rapid change in moving people on from temporary accommodation because of the pressures in the system that it created. So that has created that opportunity. It's also added the resource for all of the additional caseworkers within the homelessness system to facilitate that rapid move on as well. And it's obviously a big leverage within the housing system to increase allocations. So there is no doubt that it has had a huge impact. There's a long way to go, though. And I do think, as I said earlier, about the wider system wraparound for Housing First, it's not there in all areas yet, and it's not there in all circumstances for people. And it's people are not being seen with the same lens that someone coming from another route, say mental health or learning disability, would be treated and viewed in terms of equity of access to services. And we have big challenges in areas like Edinburgh where we simply don't have enough stock. But we do need to think differently about that. We need to think about the private rented sector. We need to think about, for instance, the role that social investment might play in helping us develop more stock. And we're actually, I'm really excited to say that our first tenant is going to be moving into a flat this week, a really lovely flat in Edinburgh this week, through a social investment route, where we've secured £5 million to buy tenancies, provide access for people who can't access mainstream housing as quickly as perhaps any of us would like.
I think Beth Watts is looking to come in off the back of that. Briefly, please. Dr. Watts.
Hello?
Briefly, please, Dr. Watts.
Yes, absolutely. In the strongest possible terms, the answer to the question is yes. What Housing First and Rapid Rehousing mean in the very simplest terms is ensuring that people experiencing homelessness have access to what all of the rest of us, most of the rest of us, are lucky enough and our families to take for granted, which is just access to a normal home that they can be complacent about and take for granted. So the evidence base is it absolutely enormous on this, happy to share it, but the key message for it is that people who have been rapidly housed into mainstream housing and Housing First with support, their quality of life benefits just so hugely from these things. So I wanted to emphasise that.
Thank you very much indeed, Dr. Watts. I'd now like to bring in Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, panel. Good morning, and thanks again for your submissions. I found them really helpful. You emphasise in your evidence the importance of involving people who have lived experience of homelessness. It seems good in practice and achieving this. Did the pandemic hinder progress in any way, and how do we maintain a momentum on this? Can I direct that to Lorraine and Gordon? Thanks.
Thank you. And it's a really critical aspect of everything that we do in homelessness, and it's been really welcome that over the course of the last few years it's become a central pillar to the policy development area as well, with support from Maggie's organisation in developing the All In for Change and Change Team and the Prevention Commission. I think it's easy to think that we're doing it all and we're doing it right now, but I think continued investment in this area and continuing to reach further, to reach more people and bring more voices, and to think about what voice looks like as well. And I think during the pandemic in particular, that was a big challenge in terms of being able to engage with people in any other way other than face-to-face, when we are talking about a group of people that are probably the most digitally excluded, for instance, of any groups in our society and in our communities. So being able for people to be able to engage and influence an activity when they don't have the basics of being able to connect with the world and their communities in the ways that we all have taken for granted in the last 18 months. So we need to be clear about where the barriers are, and the COVID pandemic did throw up a number of barriers for people's connection and engagement in all parts of the system, and including their opportunity to influence, that required to be resourced. And I'm sad that whilst Connecting Scotland has done incredible work across a very wide range of disadvantaged groups, one group that has not been prioritised within that are people experiencing homelessness. the work that has been done to connect people with digital devices to allow them to influence their own care and support and influence future design has been provided largely from within the third sector, some of which has been rooted by them from Connecting Scotland in individual cases, but not in any kind of strategic or organised fashion. So has the pandemic affected people's ability to do that? Then in terms of us being able to reach further, and Maggie will obviously talk more in more detail to this than I can, and connect with people's experience during the pandemic, then yes, it definitely did. And I think digital exclusion played its biggest part within that, and the fact that people weren't able to engage in face-to-face services other than some organisations like us that continued to meet with people to keep them safe and well. But there was no alternative. There was no online version of that kind of support. And I think in terms of where we're going with that, I think we need to keep the eye on that and make sure that it remains an absolute critical and central pillar, and that we find new ways for people who don't find it easy to engage in influencing activities to bring their voice to bear.
Thank you. In the interest of time, I'll just move on to my next question. The Domestic Abuse Protection Scotland Act 2021 will come into force in December 2022. It will help prevent women's homelessness by sort of barring the perpetrator of domestic abuse from the home and give landlords the ability to transfer tenancies to the survivor. How impactful do you think this will be in tackling homelessness among women, and are other improvements needed to help better assist women who are at risk of being made homeless? And I'll put that question to Maggie, please.
Thanks so much for that question. And I think it's among the suite of proposals that went alongside it that have been developed by Scottish Government in partnership with a range of organisations, including kind of women's specialist organisations, and taken together and result in the type of improvements that we all need for this group. I think there's something that we're definitely all becoming much more alive to in housing and homelessness, is that housing is fundamentally a system that is not sensitive to different forms of inequality. It's fundamentally a biased system. And when we look at the homelessness sector as a sector overall, probably it's one that's been developed over many years, geared more toward the circumstances and experiences of men rather than women. And everything that we understand about the experience of homeless being very different if I experience it as a man or as a woman. Now, that doesn't mean that men who experience homelessness experience a system that works for them either. It doesn't. It's not a system that works for everybody at all time. But it's in its very inherent design, it's not meeting the needs of women, and as Jeremy was saying earlier on, women with children that are experiencing homelessness as well. So it's an area that we can definitely all do better on. I think what it feels like is that there are a number of people coming together. I've mentioned Everyone Home Collective who have connected in with the homelessness unit at Scottish Government to just start exploring what all this means, hoping what the common understanding of it all is and what we can do first to really help move forward the discussion of making sure that our responses to homelessness are gender informed. One of the things we're really interested in doing is seeing whether we can kind of facilitate some sort of project that enables women themselves to help us focus our minds on what really matters most. And it just feels like such a fundamental gap in our understanding and speaking directly to women and working alongside women to improve the system and the services that they have and the access to the different kind of conditions and policy that you described at the opening of your question. So there's a lot to be done. There's a lot to learn from organisations already operating in this space. Specialist organisations like, say, Women's Aid, of course, Lorraine's organisation, mm-hmm. provides a number of specialist organisations for women affected by homelessness, and there's just loads to learn from that. And I think fundamentally we need to really centre this as a priority, an overarching equalities approach to homelessness in Scotland within our planning structures, to enable us to make the type of practical adjustments on the ground that we need to.
Thank you very much indeed, Maggie. Sticking to gendered response to homelessness, I bring in Ellen Whittam, please, followed by Emma Roddick.
Thanks very much, Convener. And having worked closely with the Chartered Institute of Housing and Women's Aid on their improving housing outcomes for women and children experiencing domestic abuse report that came out, we're now waiting for implementation groups to be created. And also understanding, as Marie McNair has pointed out, the gold standard domestic abuse laws that we do have. Does the panel think, and I would like to direct this to Dr. Beth Watts if I can, please, does Scottish Government policy at this point in time sufficiently take a gendered response and analysis to homelessness response and prevention? And do we need to actually revisit some of it? Thank you.
I think this has been an area of progress since the publication of the first Ending Homelessness Together Action Plan, and I think other members of the panel have been more closely involved in that with that than I have. So in terms of progress today, I'd probably want to defer to them. Your question specifically refers to homelessness prevention, and I think the point I'd want to emphasise there is that homelessness prevention as a sort of concept can seem quite kind of vague and loose and large, but I think there are an awful lot of tools that we can use to sort of break that down into really practical things. There's a very useful typology of homelessness prevention that distinguishes between sort of universal upstream prevention about lowering the risk among the population at large, to targeted prevention, you know, to those about to experience homelessness, to preventing people who've already experienced it from experiencing it again. I think prevention of rough sleeping is very, very different to prevention of family homelessness among you know, women with children in the household, for example. So I guess the key message I want to say is, in taking forward, I very much hope the Prevention Review Group recommendations, which would be an enormous, brilliant step forward in Scotland, there is a need to focus on those specific subgroups as well. Women, rough sleepers specifically, young people as well, those leaving institutions. And we can do a lot of very, very specific things to improve prevention work for all of those groups, including through a gendered lens, which is absolutely essential, but one of a number of lenses we need to take, I would say.
Yeah, thanks very much for that answer. And could I perhaps ask Gordon for his kind of opinion on that, having had women come to shelter for advice in terms of homelessness through domestic abuse?
I think we have to hold our hands up and say that the Ending Homelessness Together plan initially had some blind spots. Gender analysis was one. We've not touched on, you know, homelessness is experienced by marginalised groups, be that economic, be that, you know, people with disabilities, people of colour, which often goes under the radar in Scotland as well. And I think there has been some progress, I would say limited progress, made since then. I think Scottish Women's Aid in particular should be commended for quite constructively challenging some of the missing elements of the Ending Homelessness Together plan, and then have made themselves, you know, central to that work that you mentioned with CIH, and I know you've been personally involved in. I think we have to go further. We certainly see that the voice of women and children in the homelessness system is very limited. When we talk about ensuring the voice of people with lived experience, we need to make sure it's the lived experience of the whole of the homelessness system. And at Shelter Scotland, we run what we call the Time for Change programme, which is people who have experienced homelessness providing peer support to other people going through the system. And, you know, we're not doing enough yet to provide that sort of gendered lens, that, you know, female peers to support females going through that system, and the pandemic has certainly made that harder. But for me, this goes back to the point I was making earlier on, and that if we only focus on a few areas at the expense of the system as a whole, we create perverse, unintended consequences. And, you know, I just keep going back to the fact that in 6 years, since 2014, there's been a 75% increase in children in temporary accommodation in Scotland. That is something that we have the power within Scotland to address. I mean, we need to give a voice to the women and children going through that system properly so that we can understand their needs. And I'm not convinced that organisations like my own can accurately reflect them at this point in time.
Thank you very much, Dee Gordon. Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you, Convener. This question is for Lorraine, but given the focus on the shelter contribution on prevention, Gordon might want to come in as well. How much of the fact that certain groups are more at risk of homelessness do you think stems from the accessibility of local authority housing policy or the rigidity of application processes? And what changes do you think could be made to address that difference?
I think in terms of when you look at high-risk groups, such as prison leavers, care leavers, women experiencing, then there is a lot of variability in terms of people's experience of how they access the housing system and what response they get. We're not doing well in a lot of these areas. We are still seeing a lot of challenges, particularly in the context that we operate. We see a lot of challenges for prison leavers, for people who have been involved in the criminal justice system, have lost their accommodation or lost their access to their home as a result. Better for long-term sentences, but still not perfect, but certainly any short-term sentences, remand, release from court, these are all areas where we see struggling to access the housing system on release and struggling to get appropriate offers of accommodation because of some of the challenges that they experience and the availability within the system not being matched or designed around the needs of people with complex and challenging circumstances and complex and challenging histories as well. So again, I guess I would link in with the point that Gordon was making about the whole system and the read across all the different forms of homelessness and all the different impacts of homelessness is important when we think about what accommodation should look like and what access to the housing system can look like. In terms of what we can do better, it comes back to that equity of access, that someone who comes to the system through the homelessness route should be experiencing the same responses as anyone else in the system, particularly around health and social care interventions, because it is often that will make the difference to that person's ability to access the housing system and access sustainable living circumstances and a stable home thereafter. One of the things I'm probably concerned about, and I'm picking up on, whilst I agree with Gordon, there is one of the things that there is dangers in the system just now, that we start to think that bits of it are fixed, like our response to rough sleeping, and we are very good at responding to rough sleeping, but we are not yet very good at preventing people being at risk of rough sleeping, so we are still requiring a lot of resources and a lot of investment to maintain that very positive position that we have, and that's across the multi-agency response. So, and it's in that space that those high-risk groups quite often find themselves, because they've not been able to access the housing system. We do regularly see people with care experience. We do regularly see women accessing our emergency services and crisis response services because of a breakdown in relation or fleeing violence. We see people leaving prison on Friday afternoons and arriving when the system isn't available to respond to them, even if there's a good response there, arriving at our services on a Friday afternoon. And it's increasingly challenging to maintain that. And these are people that would end up off sleeping if we were in any way to take our foot off the pedal in terms of the multi-agency response that we have in place at the moment.
Emma had suggested that Gordon McRae may want to come in on that. Gordon, do you have any further brief reflections?
Just very, very briefly. I think this goes to the prevention model. I think it's how do we ensure that where people are and where they become at risk of homelessness, the system is able to respond to them. And whilst we have quite considerable reservations about some of the proposals around a prevention duty being placed, or how we would adapt the existing work responsibilities of local authorities, we wholeheartedly agree that wider public bodies such as health, justice, and education should have a legal responsibility to consider homelessness and to ask about homelessness. Because when we look at those groups that aren't well represented within the policymaker frameworks or within the discussions. We have to consider, do we only focus on adapting homelessness, or do we look at adapting those services that they are approaching, that they are accessing? And I think that's where we can make the biggest gains. And I think the prospect of a prevention duty on other bodies, and also the Scottish Government's commitment to embedding the human right to adequate housing in any future economic and social rights legislation, provides us opportunities to take homelessness out of the housing sector alone and into the wider public and social responses that we have to the trauma that people experience.
Emma Roddick.
Yes, going back to Lorraine, how much do you think that a negative initial response would turn these groups off from interacting with housing services in the future?
It plays a huge part. The trauma impacts that people are living with in terms of their ability to make informed decision making, the survival experiences that they have on a day-by-day basis, just in terms of getting through that day, means that their ability to sit back, rationalise and think, OK, I'll come back tomorrow and maybe it'll be a different story, is just not there. And it often takes a huge amount of effort, time and energy of the support services and frontline support workers to often persuade people to re-engage with the service, and for that to be a big enough priority for them in the face of, you know, chronic addictions and survival living and just getting through the day and feeling more in control of their circumstance and more in control of the choices that they have. They simply don't engage. We make it too hard for people. And one of the things, certainly one of the learning from the pandemic, is that where we do have good quality emergency accommodation that can be rapidly accessed, and that the actual control of that access is in that frontline team, now we can make things happen for people in exactly that circumstance, get them into a stable environment, a high quality environment, wrap good engagement and quality, compassionate response around them, and then very quickly move from there to access to the fuller system, including the housing system. And we were able to do that for an awful lot of people who we had not been able to do that for before, because we could make it happen there and then. We could make it happen there and then without any further process. And it was of sufficient quality and comfort and warmth and compassion and wraparound support 24 hours a day. And the vast majority of people did move on within the housing system to better settled or temporary accommodation options from that hotel base. But, you know, as the points were made earlier, hotel accommodation is not ideal for any for the longer term. But the notion of rapid access accommodation of a sufficient quality, with sufficient wraparound support, for these particularly high-risk groups is really important.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Lorraine. Just before I bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy, I'd like to turn to Lorna Campbell, please, on just to reflect from a local authority perspective on the priority groups that were raised in an earlier answer from Lorraine, particularly the policies that you've put in place in the authority to respond particularly for prison leavers, for Black, Asian, minority ethnic groups, and for women and particularly children fleeing domestic violence. Is there anything you can reflect on from a local authority perspective in terms of what you're doing there to try to help those people?
Thank you. Certainly from a local authority perspective, we have a number of policies and procedures in place, particularly around these groups. For prison leavers, we work very closely with we've got local prison as well as our justice services to look at housing direct from prison. And we have had some, prior to the pandemic, we did have some limited success. And even during the pandemic, we did look at actually early intervention and planned releases. And as I think has been mentioned, release from prison, you know, we know it's going to happen, and it's about getting those networks in place with prison services we followed what was the Shore standards that came out over, you know, 2 years ago to actually get that in place. And it has worked quite well for quite a number of, but it's still, and I think it's been reflected on, a work in progress. And it does take that cross-service close working to actually make that happen. And unfortunately, we do still have situations where the Friday night somebody's released and, you know, comes up on homeless service doorstep and we have to respond very quickly and not in a planned way. But that is something that is work in process. And I think for most local authorities, there is plans in place and there is varying degrees of success for that across authorities, and it will depend on how well their partnerships are working. Particularly for other areas similar with domestic violence, again, we have local arrangements and commissions with our women's aid services, who locally are excellent services and do provide that, and we work closely with them and homeless about ensuring that if we have temporary accommodations needed, that it is provided there and that we can fast access permanent housing. And touched on earlier, it can be challenging, particularly with women with families, accessing housing where it's needed. As a large rural local authority, there is particular challenges round about that, because obviously we don't want to move children away from their schooling areas or sport areas. So these families may spend longer in temporary accommodation than we would like, simply because of that challenge. But it is, again, a work in progress to try and identify these accommodations as quickly as possible and move, support families to move on where possible.
Thank you very much. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. I want to just continue the theme of equalities a bit and ask about disabled people who are presenting as homeless, and the panel, probably particularly just in the interest of time, Lorraine and Gordon, if you could briefly explain what's the experience just now of disabled people who are applying through the homelessness route, and are there enough accessible homes being built to put people into?
I don't think it's very different for disabled people, and I don't think they always find themselves going into the most suitable forms of accommodation, emergency temporary accommodation. And I think it just plays back into the lack of the range of options available to people and the challenges that local authorities have in terms of being able to respond in the moment for people in crisis. In terms of access to accessible housing, it's really challenging. It's particularly challenging. And if I take Edinburgh as an example, you know, even with people who would have what's known as gold priority under the Common Housing Register application process, there, the index, they are within that group alongside so many other people with similar priority. So being able to support people to access appropriately designed accommodation to meet their needs is particularly challenging. I would like to say that people always get a really good response, but they don't. I mean, we've had situations where people have been in hospital having amputations who are within the homelessness system, and the planned discharge is back to a tenement flat upstairs. So it's again, it's that very personal circumstance. Again, back to that equity of access that I mentioned earlier, that we're not responding to people who unfortunately have a homelessness label and are through that route that's generally out with the health and social care system, that we view differently and we respond differently. Because we would never contemplate that for an older person or for someone that's come through the system from a different route.
Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed. I'd now like to bring in Marie McNair for the final theme of questions, please.
Thank you, Convener. This is a question for Beth Watts. It's about future developments. Like you, I think we can make real progress with powers we have. But UK policy is a hindrance in some respect. You say in the Homelessness Monitor that changes to welfare policy, including increasing the local housing allowance, would assist in reducing homelessness. Is that just you stating the obvious, or is there any optimism for the movement in that regards?
That's a great question. I think undoubtedly these are really important parts of the picture in terms of responding to homelessness adequately across the UK and in Scotland. In many parts of Scotland, there is a positive story because the housing market context is somewhat more positive than certainly in the south of England and London. So some of these really pernicious welfare reforms we've seen drive up homelessness since 2010 did actually have less of an impact in Scotland, but they obviously have really, really challenging impacts across the country nevertheless, and especially in places like Edinburgh. Obviously, the raising of the local housing allowance rate was a really important part. The COVID response really helped, certainly in Edinburgh, I'm sure elsewhere. It's very, very sad to see it refrozen. We're currently in the process of writing the Homelessness England Monitor, where we try and get a sense of any likely policy movement on these issues. I think, we have no special insight on that I can offer, but I don't think we'll be seeing radical changes in local housing allowance rates, the benefit cap, things like that, that we continue to see as a real problem. I do want to add, one of the members of the committee mentioned earlier discretionary housing payments in the Scottish Welfare Fund. In our Scottish Homelessness Monitor work, local authorities are very, very clear how enormously valuable these pots of money are in terms of responding to and preventing homelessness. So I just wanted to underline that. And they do offer local authorities a bit of a resource for dealing with a very not ideal welfare safety net as decided by UK government. And as just a final comment, this is a challenging welfare policy context for Scotland to tackle homelessness within. But I would just want to redirect to the levers that are in the hands of Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament, and how much can be done within that. But yeah, very much agree on the broad thrust of your comment, and we'll keep making those arguments directed at Westminster.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to the theme of prevention and future opportunities for the Scottish Government, because we know within the programme for government it does contain plans to strengthen the law around homelessness prevention. Now, I would put on record that I often feel people have to declare themselves homeless before any support is made available. So I wanted to know from the panel what your ideal model would be going forward to try to change that, so support does start earlier. And some of the ideas put forward, for example, was public sector bodies having a conversation with vulnerable individuals 6 months out from that being a necessary crisis point. So I'll maybe start with Gordon, because you touched upon this earlier, and then go around whoever else wants to come in.
Thank you. As I mentioned, there are a couple of opportunities on the horizon. I think you'll hear quite a lot of consensus from many of us today, but there are probably some differences in nuance and focus, and I think this is one of them. Certainly at Shelter Scotland, we fully endorse the proposal of the Prevention Review Group around extending some of those provisions around our responsibility to prevent homelessness to other public bodies. And we also endorse the moving from 2 to 6 months, the potential for people who are at risk of being homeless, being able to for the public body, the local authority, to actually start that preventative work. Where we are sceptical right now is around downgrading form of tenancy that people get at the end of that process, from what's currently called permanent to stable accommodation. We recognise that would allow some of the shared accommodation models that have been discussed earlier, but we don't yet have those shared accommodation models, and I think it would be a significant risk to level down our kind of drive towards security of tenure as being the proposed outcome for people going through the homelessness system. The other area we're concerned about is any duty on local authorities to relieve homelessness for people who already meet the definition of statutory homelessness. Because if you meet the definition of statutory homeless, that should be a trigger for a support needs assessment, for other forms of intervention from the local authority. I think some of this will come out as we as we develop some of the proposals, and I'm sure there's some space to find a way that brings that consensus. But we, I think we sometimes get trapped in discussing principles rather than the details. And whilst we're very supportive of the principle behind the prevention duty, I think there are some devil in the detail of the way it's currently framed.
So I can see that Dr. Beth Watts is looking to come in, as is Lorna Campbell and Lorraine McGrath. So Dr. Watts first, please, followed by Lorna Campbell.
I just wanted to respond directly to the concern from Gordon, which I'm familiar with, that the PRG recommendations are sort of weakening of the rights of homeless households. And it's just not something that resonates with me at all and my colleagues. And I know, the people that were, the very wide range of people that were involved in developing the proposals. The proposals are designed to offer greater flexibility to both homeless applicants and local authorities, so the most appropriate form of accommodation can be found. Many homeless applicants are single young people, and permanent social housing, a permanent council house, might not be the most suitable option or what they want. Other aspects of housing beyond security of tenure are really, really important too, location, for example. And in any case, I'd want to emphasise that the proposal is that where the offer isn't a permanent social or private let, that the applicant has an absolute right of veto over that offer. They can refuse it without penalty. No one's forcing anyone to take any not settled accommodation. And the proposals also include increases in the safeguards that homeless applicants have going through this process, including strengthened appeal and review rights. So I think this adds up to a package that substantially enhances people's rights rather than restricts them. And this will be an ongoing conversation, I very much hope and expect. So I hope we can iron that all out. And I'll pass over to others now.
Lorna Campbell, please, followed briefly by Larry McGrath.
Thank you. Jennifer, in my view, and what we've been fighting for quite a time, is better prevention in place, because if we're going to end homelessness and the dependence on temporary accommodation, we need to upstream prevention much earlier. And that wider partnership, particularly with health and social care, and identifying threats of homelessness at an earlier opportunity gives us a better chance to work with individuals, and be it an economic response or whether it is about sourcing better or more sustainable housing earlier, can help people. Often we're seen in homeless services as it's the crisis. People only come to homeless services when it's a crisis and they're homeless tonight or an immediate threat, which limits the time we have to help and support people. Moving that further back and identifying it earlier would be key, because we're in a rather vicious circle at the moment in the local authorities. You know, at the moment we've got an increased demand for temporary accommodation, which means we've got to, hence locally, is take extra accommodation from housing associations and private landlords, which then reduces the amount of accommodation we've got to discharge permanent accommodation. So there's that bit of vicious circle-ness. So that earlier prevention stops the need for so much temporary accommodation, and it's something we've been very keen to progress. But time and resource means we're constantly firefighting at the moment, and it's something we need to start to upstream far more effectively going forward.
Finally, briefly, Lorraine.
Yeah, I just wanted to make the point that whilst legislation is really important, and I wholly support all of the recommendations for the PRG and the widening of range of options for people in terms of their accommodation options, legislation itself is not enough. A huge amount of this is about attitudes and behaviours and that silo effect that we have for people experiencing and the range of professionals. We know where the touch points largely are. We know where the opportunities are to intervene at a much earlier stage. We know that we are not making best use of our range of data, whether that be from the benefit system or within the local authority system. We're not making best use of the soft intelligence, people's points of connection as well within the system, whether that's someone that's looking at a social welfare fund application for somebody, or just somebody who encounters someone in a doctor's surgery. We know that engagement with the health system, evidence is strong, that is almost always happens right before people's first episode of homelessness. So there's lots of opportunities that the legislation will support, but we also need to think about how we actually change attitudes, behaviours, and that people see value in acting, asking and acting, value to their part of the system and their job with that person in front of them at that moment in time.
Thank you very much indeed, Lorraine. A brief question from Miles Briggs, followed by Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. Just very briefly, I wanted to go back to a point which Gordon McRae had made earlier with regards to Edinburgh and the east of Scotland and specific pressures which we're seeing within our cities, really, with regards to delivering services. Now, Mr Balfour, Mr Chowdhury and myself represent Edinburgh. We see and know from our public bodies the pressures which Edinburgh does face delivering these services. So I wondered in terms of potential solutions around that and whether or not you would support, for example, pressured areas like we've seen developed for London specifically, given the cost of delivering services we've seen, or other suggestions around the specific city issue which you've highlighted. I'll maybe bring in Gordon as I reference you back to that question.
Certainly. We, in partnership with the Chatham-shire Housing, Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, commissioned a affordable housing needs analysis ahead of the last Scottish election. And it certainly identified that the east cluster of local authorities was the area where it was the greatest demand and was not being was not having the delivery of new social housing. And I want to be very clear, we're talking about social housing, not other forms of affordable housing in this context, at the scale at which it required. And that was compounded by the evidence that came from Audit Scotland's review of the delivery of the affordable housing programme, which, as I said earlier, identified that it lacked any measure of success beyond just the number of units. And of course, it's self-evident that we could build them. If we build all the disproportionate number of the units in places where there isn't the same demand, then we are not alleviating pressure within the system. And that's why we're calling on the Scottish Government to produce an annual social justice, social housing report so that we can monitor the social impact of that programme, so that there are outcomes beyond just a single number of units. I'm not familiar enough with the London example you raised, but I'm happy to look at that and come back to the committee afterwards with a view.
Thank you very much indeed, Gordon. Finally, Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you, Convener. Dr Watts, I note that in the written contribution you favoured raising housing allowance. I wondered, when housing allowance is raised, how much do you think that the benefit to people struggling to afford housing is offset by private landlords raising the rents in response?
Yeah, that's definitely a concern, and my understanding of the evidence from academics at Sheffield Hallam is that that is part of the effect, but not all of the effect. I probably want to defer to an expert on private sector market dynamics, but I certainly don't think that's a reason not to keep local housing allowance rates in line with a decent proportion of the private rented sector. And certainly the modelling that Glenn Bramley, my colleague, does here shows that it will make a real difference to that. So that would want to be my point of emphasis. In terms of landlords' behavioural responses, that's a hugely important question that should be sort of in the policy debate as well, but I'd want to defer to someone with expertise on that more than my own.
Thank you. And just following on from that, Gordon, how much do you think that no DSS listings are affecting the ability of homeless people to find accommodation, and what can be done to address that?
So this is something that's really been addressed. My colleagues in Shelter in England have really led some work on this, taking some test cases, strategic litigation, to demonstrate that it is a form of discrimination for a landlord to list accommodation with no DHSS. It still remains. You can go onto any listings website and still see it today. We have chosen to address it through approaching letting agents and landlord bodies, but that only takes us so far, because we know that 94% of landlords in Scotland have one property. So we have a vast, and I don't mean this in a pejorative way, but a vast amateur landlord sector. The people that join Scottish Landlords Association, so they're the professionals, they're the ones that know their rights and responsibilities. The problem is that the largest proportion of accommodation is not yet being managed by people with the right level. That creates a problem because that is disproportionately at the lower end of the market. That is where people who are homeless or at risk of homelessness are more likely to be seeking accommodation, and where we know that, you know, universal credit is an in-work benefit. This is not something which is about people who are homeless, people who are otherwise at risk. We're talking here about people who are simply reliant on the welfare system because the housing system is broken and doesn't provide housing at a cost that's commensurate with wages in our current economy. So it is a major barrier. It's one that the courts have already addressed. The issue now is practice within a broadly amateur private landlord sector.
Thank you.
Thank you to all the panel for your time this morning. We've provided some considerable latitude and extended the time for this session, and it was really interesting to hear from all of you and all of your insights into this area, and has certainly been of benefit to all of us on the committee and our extended committee today. And I should say thank you very much to Eleanor Whittam for joining us and for her contributions too. I really appreciate your time and your patience with some of the technical difficulties that we have. Broadcasting have suggested the very technical term that Blue Jeans was sticking at some points. So I thank you for your perseverance and also Broadcasting for ensuring that things went as smoothly as possible. Thank you very much indeed. And we'll move on to agenda item 4 while we just wait for people to change position. Thank you very much indeed, colleagues. We move to agenda item 4. The committee is invited to consider a negative SSI, the Council Tax Reduction Scotland Amendment No. 4, Regulations 2021. Background to these regulations outlined in paper 7. Members will note that the regulations were drawn to the attention of the Parliament by the DPLR committee under their reporting ground J. This is because the instrument was laid less than 28 days before coming to force. However, it was also noted by that committee that these regulations were introduced on an emergency basis to provide access to the Council Tax Reduction Scheme to people arriving from Afghanistan. The DPLR committee was therefore satisfied with the reasons given for the breach of the 28-day rule. Do members have any comments to make on this particular regulation? Nope. Are members content to note the instrument? Thank you very much indeed. That concludes the public part of this morning's meeting. I suspend the meeting and move to private session. Thank you very much. Members who are joining online should move to the link provided.